Over the last several years, not only did I have a chance to work with Brad Bird, the writer-director of Ratatouille, but also with Thomas Keller. And Thomas is one of America's finest chefs. He owns the French Laundry in Persei. And when you see these guys work, you start to see a similar, not only sparkle in their eye and you know, how they do what they do, but also they're really intense. They've got this attention to detail, and they're very passionate about their work. So one's about cooking, and one's about making great movies, but there is this harmonic in their approach. So I sat down and had a conversation with both of them, and they shared a little bit of their perspective.
All right, for two tasting. Sub one custard, please, for Oyster and Pearl. Sub a Suzuki for a Lobster Chef. Let's pick up, Chef. Two Dorado, two Amachi, when ready.
Anybody can cook. It's just you have to have the desire, the determination to make something that you're going to feel proud to give to somebody, have that emotional connection with somebody. I think you have to be emotionally attached to what you're doing. And certainly with food, I mean, it's very easy because it's something that nurtures.
You're constantly trying to get the audience into the state of feeling and how things feel rather than how things are. You are trying to get to a very primal, very simple, I think, nourishing thing, which is indulging in the human aspect of being alive. Every idea comes about in its own way. I had an idea for a film that started with me hearing a song and thinking it was another song.
Walking down the aisle of a grocery store and seeing a purple box of pearl tapioca, and you see a word that says pearls, and you associate that with an oyster, and then comes from that as a dish.
Other things come out of just a thought that you have of what if, or superheroes must feel defeated sometimes.
And the food can be so inspiring. Comes in its raw form. And you think, okay, what am I gonna do with this? What are we looking at when we're trying to define a new dish? We're really looking at the end product. What do we want to see in the dish? What do we want to feel in our mouth? What do we want to smell? What do we want to taste? And then we work backwards in establishing the different techniques or the different products that we're gonna use that are gonna result in that end. Take the coronet of salmon, which we do here. The inspiration came from an ice cream cone. From that ice cream cone, I actually saw that salmon coronet. And then working back and trying to figure out the technique. I mean, how many times have you had a cracker with cream, onions, and salmon? Many times. What is surprising and what's amusing about it is the shape.
The mistake that a lot of people make is thinking that you can force ideas to come. You can't, really. All that you can do is observe what kind of environment puts you in a creative state of mind, and then try to create that environment.
Take the example of cleaning a salmon. I mean, you clean a salmon every day for 10 or 15 years. I mean, it becomes part of who you are. You don't really have to think about cleaning the salmon. So by doing that kind of task, you're actually liberated to be thinking about other things. And at that point, you can start to think about not cleaning the salmon, but what am I gonna do with the salmon after I clean it?
Is that a traditional way you've done in the past versus flat, or is it something you're just doing on the fly?
Let's just do it.
That's great.
You know, sometimes things just get you at the last moment.
Uh-huh. One of the exciting things about doing something spontaneous is the risk. Are you going to fail or are you going to succeed? If you succeed at it, how can you make that dish feel spontaneous over and over and over again without it becoming somewhat old in your feeling? And I think that really is about us as cooks, making sure that each dish that we do is something that is as fresh and as dynamic as it was the first time that we did that.
Animation is the same way. It's not a spontaneous act, but if you do it artfully, you get the feeling of spontaneous thought. I've seen people shoot footage of themselves and watch it and literally pick a little part from this shot and then a little bit from take two. Oh, I like that thing that I accidentally did with my hands there. I didn't know I was doing it, but look at it. It's kind of cool. If I put that over here and kind of assemble spontaneous moments, that can be put into a scene that feels spontaneous, but it has the graphic power, moment to moment, of precise visual decision making. If you do it well, it will feel spontaneous.
My mother ran restaurants, and as the youngest of five boys, I spent a lot of time after school in the restaurants. And how that manifested itself into me becoming a cook really was just my mother would give me a job. I mean, it was, I had job security. I have a mentor, Roland Hennen, and I met him in the early 70s, and he was a chef in a private club in Rhode Island where I was working. And he made me understand that there was an emotional connection, and that was actually cooking for somebody in a way that brought them pleasure. And that was really that moment that changed my points of view on what I was doing and why I was doing it. I started to look for role models for other chefs that I wanted to be like. And there was one chef that really stood out. It was Ferdinand Point. His book, for me, really resonated what the qualities of a cook were. And that was about the product, and about execution, and about interpretation of what you know how to do, what you feel inside yourself, and how to express that onto a plate.
Well, I made a film starting at age 11 that took me 3 years to make. And I entered it in some contests, and it won some awards. And I sent it to Disney. They responded right away and were amazing to me. They opened their doors and said, you can work with one of our great animators. Whenever you're in LA, the door is open. And I made sure I got to LA. So I got assigned to work with Milt Kahl. And Milt was one of the greatest artists that has ever lived. And he was tough. He was tough. I mean, he did it in a nice way. He wasn't cruel to me, but he let me know absolutely where I was coming up short. The Disney guys constantly showed you how to draw things so that the audience clearly saw them. They were the best graphic representation of an idea, but to do it in a way that didn't look like you were striking poses, that looked natural and felt flowing.
And I went to Paris, where it was a wonderful time. I was able to get jobs in different restaurants and experience France. And I model so much of what our organization is about on that restaurant called Taillevent, on that role model, Jean-Claude Vinant. I mean, he's just an extraordinary restaurateur. Every morning I'd walk through the courtyard and I'd look up to the second floor window of his office, and he was there every morning. Every night I left, he was there. He was there all the time. And you look at that, and that, those examples of people like that, and you understand what makes them great. It's commitment.
Everybody's been working their butts off on this film, and it's a hard film to do. But now we have a straight shot here where we have to kick into gear, because we are not going to get the film done if we don't sail into this new year. I think that what you try to do is get people excited by what you're excited about.
You still see Skinner's hand, and suddenly there's just stairs going down, and he's airborne. Okay. And we gotta have that, man. That's like the greatest shot ever.
I really love capturing moments, and I love trying to hit new standards. And if I can get somebody to see that little carrot out there, and it's just there, it's like, they're here and it's wonderful, it looks great, but if they go this much further, they can make the shot that nobody's made.
Okay, we got it.
All right.
Yay! Woo!
If you can make them feel that, they get that little extra oomph and they feel wonderful later, because
all right,
so many people have greatness in them, you know what I mean? It's just coaching it out of them.
You put a little bit too much pressure on that bread when you're slicing it. That's why it crumbles on the edges on you, you know what I'm saying?
Yes.
It's not about perfection, it's about the quest for perfection. That's the motivating thing. Because you realize once you think it's perfect, it's no longer perfect. It can't be. I mean, I think it's perfect, and therefore it's not.
You could finesse that turn by a couple of frames. People have told me that I can be demanding, but I think I'm enthusiastically demanding. I don't think that I'm mean about it. I think that I go, great. Now, if you could just do one more thing.
It's fantastic. Great job. Can you do one tiny little thing?
I have two minor notes, and they're not a big deal.
You got it. The only thing you need to do now is just a little bit of eyelid stuff and a little bit of more brow stuff.
I'll go, can I get this, this, and this, and then that'll be it. And then they'll give me that, that, and that, and I'll see one more thing that would make it better. And I can't help myself. I'll go, just
Can we get the?
It's like anything in life. When you do something, you know, what makes it better? What makes you better than somebody else? It's your understanding of what you're doing, and being able to just tweak it, to finesse that a little bit. The way somebody plates a dish, you know, it's not just putting it on the dish. You've got to finesse the way it goes down. Look at it. Think about it. Make sure it's right there. Tweak it a little bit. Make it just off center. Do that.
If you try to over-control the process, you limit the process. I mean, I have a pretty strong idea of what I want, but I don't feel that I create an atmosphere where people can't speak up and have ideas, because oftentimes people come up with wonderful ideas that are gonna make the movie better, and you'd be an idiot not to take them.
And I'm a firm believer in collaboration. You really have to have a lot of courage as a young cook to be in that process, because many times you'll say something that won't be impactful. And for somebody who's young, it kind of shuts them down. But you just have to keep that process going. You have to keep encouraging them to think about what they're doing in a way that they can then give you something back. They can own what they're doing in a way, and once you own it, it becomes yours. The level of execution, the level of commitment is heightened that much more. We have signs in our restaurant which says sense of urgency. And it's so important that from the time you get to work, you live with that phrase in your head, making sure that you're focused on the task and making sure that you're gonna get there to get the task done. And then you're gonna move on to the next one. It's the pressure of the situation that makes you achieve a higher performance.
Every second counts, and you cannot be mommy!
There's a sense of energy that you get, and it's that energy and that excitement that make you perform that much better in that pressure situation.
If you think about what you're doing logically, you are trying to invent what an audience that you likely will never meet will enjoy 2 years from now. But you can't think of it that way. You have to think about it in terms of, what do I want to see? What delights me?
So really, it's looking to ourselves and saying, are we happy with what we've done? Am I happy with what I've done? Is the most important, is what we gauge our success on.
So I think that you've got to make something that pleases you and hope that other people feel the same way.
That's an emotional connection, where you have that emotional connection in what you're doing with food, you have emotional connection with your guest, with your staff, and the supplier, you're all together. You're all on the same page there. But I think one of the most motivating things is setting an example. You're a chef de partie, I'm a commis. You're setting an example for me that makes me want to be you.
I want people to be excited about the medium. I want them to be proud of their work afterwards.
Your legacy, really, is to be able to pass on to somebody else the task, the philosophy, the culture that you established yourself.
And if I can help grow that feeling about the film, about the medium, and, you know, working in it, then I feel like I'm doing a good thing, because I love this medium.